Hello and welcome back to my channel. Today's video is my third video in a series on swaps. Today we'll learn about two different approaches to pricing interest rate swaps. Hi guys, welcome back to my YouTube channel. If this is the first one of my videos you've watched, you should check out some of the others, where we're trying to learn about quantitative finance and derivatives. Make sure you subscribe if you'd like to see more content like this. Anyhow, let's get on with it and learn about how we price interest rate swaps. We'll work through the example from my book, which is called Trading and Pricing Financial Derivatives. There's a link to it in the description below. As explained in my first video on swaps, which I'll link to above, swaps are usually structured such that they can be valued at zero at inception. This allows the two parties to the swap to get going without any cash flow. A swap can be priced at zero when the NPV, or net present value, of both cash flows is equal. Once the swap agreement has been entered into, it can take on a positive or a negative valuation, and that just occurs once the market rates for whatever the two cash flows are changes. Swaps are a zero-sum game, meaning that one counterparty's gain is equal to the other counterparty's loss. If you receive fixed in a swap, the swap value equals the present value of fixed cash flows minus the present value of floating cash flows. If you pay fixed in a swap, the swap value equals the present value of floating cash flows minus the present value of fixed cash flows. So basically what I'm saying is that the value of a swap equals the present value of whatever you're receiving less the present value of whatever it is that you have to pay out. Hopefully that makes sense to you, and it's not very complicated. For this reason, swaps are amongst the easiest derivatives that there are to value. There's no complicated formula like with the Black-Scholes-Merton model. There's no stochastic calculus, no drawing of lattices like in the binomial tree, and no generating price paths like with the Monte Carlo method. All you have to do is lay out the expected cash flows and then present value them. So that's really all there is to it. And then the swap is worth to you the present value of what you get less the present value of what you have agreed to pay. Whatever profit you've made on the swap, your counterparty has lost. And whatever loss that you might have made on the swap, your counterparty will have gained. That's it. Once we know that, we can use whichever method we prefer to present value the cash flows. If you've ever priced a bond, you can price a swap. Some people get a little bit confused when valuing a swap because we sometimes lay out the cash flows a little bit differently to how you might lay them out when you're pricing a bond. But essentially it's still the same thing. We just kind of group it all together into a table with a swap because you're able to see it all at once. But in truth, you can just price one bond, price the other bond, and you know the value of the swap is what you're receiving less what you're paying. So you can do this however you want, but in my book, I cover two approaches, so let's work through them here. A plain vanilla interest rate swap can be priced as either a combination of a long position in one bond and a short position in another bond, or as a portfolio of forward rate agreements. All of the discounting is done using LIBOR, zero coupon interest rates, as it's assumed that the risk on the cash flows is equivalent to a loan in the interbank market. Let's start out with a description of a swap, and then we will value it using each of our different approaches. Suppose that a swap has been in existence for some time already, and that we now are looking to value it. Assume that it pays floating 6-month LIBOR versus 5% fixed semi-annually. It's on $100 million notional and has 1¾ years remaining to maturity. Suppose we know that LIBOR continuously compounded is 6%, 6.5%, 7%, and 7.3% for the 3-month, 9-month, 15-month, and 21-month periods. We are also aware that on the last payment date, 6-month LIBOR price was 6.2%. What is the value of this swap? So that's what we have to solve. There are two methods to do this calculation. One calculates the equivalent bond values, one fixed and one floating, and takes the difference between these present values. The other method involves calculating the value of the swap as a portfolio of FRAs, or forward rate agreements, for each of the upcoming payment periods, and then taking the present value of the differences in fixed versus floating cash flows from each upcoming payment period. On screen right now, you can see the calculations of the bond valuation method, which is what we're going to work through first. The value to the receive fixed counterparty is the fixed bond valuation minus the floating bond valuation. We can see that the swap is worth minus $4.22 million. The opposing counterparty will have the opposite value, so they will see the value as plus $4.22 million. So what have we done in there? We just put together a table of the expected cash flows for each bond and the timing of the payments remaining on the swap. The fixed payments are easy enough. They are just $2.5 million each period, and because we're valuing this as if it was a bond, $102.5 million at the last payment. We use the LIBOR rates from the question to present value those cash flows, so the column labeled discount factor is just E to the discount rate, which in the first payment period, 3 months, is 6%. So that is E to the minus 6% times 3 over 12, which is 3 months out of the 12 months in a year. That gives us 0.9851. We do the same calculation, subbing in the different applicable interest rates and holding periods, and we calculate all of the different discount rates. We then just multiply those discount rates by the $2.5 million cash flows and the final $102.5 million cash flow, sum them all up, and that is the value of the fixed rate bond, which you can see in our example that it's $97.3419 million. The next step is to present value the floating rate bond. How do we do that? Well, a basic semi-annual coupon floating rate bond has the coupon indexed to LIBOR. Each coupon date, the coupon is equal to the par value of the note times one half the 6 month rate quoted 6 months earlier at the beginning of the coupon period. So each coupon is based on the previous 6 month rate. Only the next coupon is known at the current date. The later ones are random. Thus, a floating rate bond is always worth par on the next coupon date with certainty. And that's just because we have a floating rate being discounted at a floating rate, so it just comes to par value for the bond. So it's actually quite easy to price a floating rate bond. All we have to do is discount the upcoming coupon, which we know with certainty, at the appropriate discount rate. Now you'll note that in the question, the very last line in the question said, we are also aware that the last payment date 6 month LIBOR price was 6.2%. So to price that floating rate bond, we know that that payment is coming in 3 months. So we must PV it or present value it at the 3 month interest rate, after which the bond will be worth par. So that's all that's happening in that column that's labeled floating bond value. We have 100 million plus 100 million times 6.2% over 2, as it's a semi-annual coupon, giving us 103.1 million. We then multiply that by the discount factor, which we calculated earlier as 0.9851, and that gives us $101.565 million. The value to the receive fixed counterparty is the fixed bond valuation minus the floating bond valuation. We can then see that the swap is worth minus $4.22 million. The opposing counterparty will have the opposite value. So that's it. That's all we have to do to price our swap. Next, let's look at valuing the same swap, but this time using a different method. We're going to value the swap as a portfolio of FRAs, which stands for Forward Rate Agreement. We draw up a table with a lot of the same elements in it as in the last table. As you can see, the fixed cash flows are the same, the time periods and discount factors are the same, and they're calculated in the same method. The first floating cash flow we know in advance, and the remaining ones are calculated as shown in row 2, where we're taking the FRA continuously compounded and converting it into an FRA semi-annually compounded in the next column. We then work out the floating cash flows, subtract them from the fixed cash flows, multiply that by the discount rates to get the present value of the net cash flows. We sum up the present values of the net cash flows and get minus $4.22 million, the same as the bond method that we just did earlier. If you're having difficulty with that method, you should watch my video from a few days ago on forward rate agreements, which will explain the idea of forward rate agreements to you. So that's it, the two easiest ways to value a swap. You should probably just learn off one method, the one that you find easiest. Remember that all we're doing here, there's nothing complicated happening. We're just present valuing two cash flows and looking at the difference between them, and that's how we value a swap. If you can price a bond, you can price a swap. I haven't yet done any videos on bond valuation. Maybe I will at some point. But if you're having difficulty with bond valuation, you can probably just Google it, and there's a lot of good information that you can find online. You've made it to the end of the video, and the rules of YouTube clearly state that you have to hit the like button. So I'll wait here while you do that. Feel free to ask any questions in the comment section below. Subscribe if you'd like to see more content like this in the future, and do hit the bell button, which is right next to the subscribe button, if you wish to be notified every time I release a new video. I'm reaching the end of my daily uploads, and I'm shortly going to move to releasing just one video per week. Have a great day, and see you guys again soon. Bye.